All right, good evening, everybody. Welcome. How you doing? All right. This is the New School of Music Austin Jazz Club concert tonight. And this is a combination of Texas Jazz and Blues Camp students, as well as the Austin Jazz Club students. And Mr. Joe Morales is director of that. And my name is Andre Hayward. I am VP of Resources Development of New School of Music Austin. So glad to see these students here, and so wonderful to see them grow, first of all. And looking forward to hearing them play tonight. They're going to be playing some tunes, paying homage to the jazz masters of this music. And also I want to introduce our director of the Jazz Club, the New School Jazz Club, Mr. Joe Morales.
Thank you, Andre. Never thought we'd be VPs of anything. Like to welcome you. These kids are amazing. They represent a bunch of different schools, high schools, colleges, and yes, I still get nervous. So guys, it's okay to be nervous and just play your heart out. Play with soul, and let's play. Like Andre said, let's pay some homage to the jazz greats. And with that, I'm going to leave you with some amazing music played by these kids. All right? Thank you. While they're getting set up for the next tune, I'm going to feature Dante on piano. But I'd like to mention that all the arrangements that you are hearing were written by Ian Oliver. Who just happens to be my student.
Thank you.
There we go. I'm getting old, and I've been doing this for a long time, and I forget about switches on microphones. I'd like to introduce a new and wonderful friend who's passionate about teaching and passionate about raising money for kids that are not so fortunate and need lessons. That's why I hired Andre and I, and we are so passionate about what he's passionate about. We'd love to give a big round of applause to Richard Spencer.
Thanks so much, Joe. And actually, you know, give a round of applause for Joe and Andre, who are awesome, and have been working with the kids here in the Austin area for a long time. And we connected through our Texas Jazz and Blues Camp, does a similar thing to what you do on a weekly basis. He has the Austin Jazz Club that he founded a long time ago. When was that?
8 years ago.
Oh, wow. Wow. And we started Texas Jazz and Blues Camp in 2014. And Don Braden, who will be in the second half of the program via Zoom, is our director. And so these young guys that showed up at our place, a lot of them had already been studying with Joe for a long time. And so I simply proposed, why don't we have new school jazz clubs and let Joe run that and help us spread the goodness and have, you know, incredible people like Andre come teach. And there's a lot of guys like that in town. So that's what we're doing. And that's what this is about. And as Joe mentioned, yeah, we raise money for this. And one of our primary sources is really the City of Austin's Cultural Arts Division. This is funded in part by them. So I'll let you guys continue. And Bill Evans and Don Braden will join us second set.
All right. Now I'd like to bring, thank you, Richard. Now I'd like to bring up a little girl that I discovered when she was 13 years old because her brother said, you should hear my little sister sing. And she's been singing ever since and been my student. And I love my little Margot. So put your hands together for Margot Zell.
Mics are so fidgety. Oh my goodness. You'd think by now, I've been singing for, let's see, before I could talk. So you'd think that by now I would have mastered the microphone, right? We're gonna do a tune for you guys. This one's really fun. I think you'll like it. East of the sun and west of the moon, we'll build a dream house out of love, dear. Near to the sun in the day, near to the moon at night, we'll live in a lovely way, dear. Living our life in the pale moonlight, just you and I forever in a day. Love will not die, we will keep it that way. Up among the stars, you'll find a harmony of life to a lovely tune. East of the sun and west of the moon, dear. East of the sun and west of the moon. Thank you. Give it up for Hunter Niehaus. The sun and west of the moon, we'll build a dream house out of love, dear. Near to the sun in the day, near to the moon at night, we'll live in a lovely way, dear, living our life through the pale moonlight. Just you and I, forever in a day. Love will not die, love will not die. We will keep it that way. Up among the stars, you'll find a harmony of life to a lovely tune. East of the sun and west of the moon, dear. East of the sun and west of the moon. Ba-dee-da-dun-doo. East of the sun. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. All right, we're going to slow things down. We're going to slow things down for the first time this evening. This is a beautiful, beautiful song, one that I've loved for a really long time. It's called Round Midnight. Begins to tell round midnight, I do pretty well till after sundown. Supper time, I'm feeling sad, but it really gets bad round midnight. Memories always start round midnight, haven't got the heart to stand those memories, when my heart is still with you, and old midnight knows it too. When a quarrel we had needs mending, doesn't mean that our love is ending. Darling, I need you. Lately I find you're out of my heart and I'm out of my mind. Let our hearts take wings round midnight, let the angels sing for your returning, till our love is safe and sound, and old midnight comes. Oh. Thank you so much.
Tamara Rozelle. Thank you. She's amazing, actually. Yeah, I know you've been singing since you were two.
More or less.
Don't stop. Come on, guys. Okay, so these guys come from different schools. Huck is at the Fine Arts School, McCallum. And Zach is a junior at scholarship student at Eastman. Hunter is a sophomore scholarship student at Eastman. Lessons pay off, by the way. And that's Dante, he goes to Lhasa. And that's Lila, and she goes to McCallum, Fine Arts School. And that's Will, he goes to McCallum. Yeah. I always do this, Will Sharp, Will Sharp, Will. He's got such a cool name, you know what I mean? Ian Oliver is a student at Westlake High School, and he has big plans to join you guys at Eastman. Okay, and this is Cole, and he goes to Westlake. And this is Drake, and he goes to Westlake. And Hunter, Maggie, and Zach graduated from Lhasa and Westlake. And who did I leave out? Okay, now we're good. All right, so let's continue with the show.
Thank you.
All right, that featured Drake Lewis on alto sax. I didn't forget you, Drake. And Cole, too. You featured Cole. And you, too, Dante. And who else? Will? No. Cole. Okay. And I, you know, somebody, did I forget you, Huck? How could I forget the most important guy in the room? The drummer, okay? The drummer. Really, it's the bass player, but don't tell him. Guys, thank y'all for being with us. We're gonna do another tune, and I think we're gonna bring up the old guys. That would be Andre and me to join these young men and women. Okay, hit it.
Two choruses each. Thank you.
Thank you guys for so much for your support. I was told to get in the light. Trying to hide my wrinkles here. Thank you so much for your support. You know, it always takes supportive parents to have a successful child, whether it's in jazz, math, whatever it is. You guys, definitely not math. But thank y'all for being here and being supportive. And we'd like to thank Monks Jazz, the new school of music. You can tell I don't play much anymore. Anyway, I'm out of breath. But I will be at the Elfin Room the last Saturday of January, so join me. One more hand for these guys. And now we're going to bring up Richard Spencer.
Yeah, thank you again, Joe, and this incredible young band. Give them another hand. They're awesome. And so what we're going to do for this second portion of the program, and I know we don't have a big screen TV in here. People who are close to this one are in good shape, but Colin is able to bring in different feeds. We're going to have a feed that has Don Braden and sax great Bill Evans. And so I guess the best way for them to see Colin just be to go to your YouTube channel. Check it out on your device when those guys are on. You'll be able to see it. And then the band members are going to come back up here and do a Q&A with Bill Evans and Don Braden. Kind of like we did last year with Christian McBride, if any of y'all saw that. And so let me tell you just real quickly about Don. I'll hand it over. And Bill, Don directs our Texas Jazz and Blues Camp. He also directs the Litchfield Jazz Camp in Connecticut, which is huge. And he's a band member, alumnus of Wynton Marsalis, Freddie Hubbard, Roy Haynes, Tony Williams, Betty Carter, and a bunch more than that. And he directs the Harvard Jazz Initiative ensembles. He's composed music for ensembles ranging from duo to full symphony in many styles for recordings, has over 19 CDs as a leader and over 80 as a sideman, plus film credits, TV networks, et cetera. So he's awesome, you know, an incredible saxophonist. A lot of you here know him and have heard him over the years because we bring him to Austin from the East Coast several times a year. Bill Evans, similar, you know, amazing guy. He also played with Miles Davis, but he's not a pianist. He's a saxophonist. And he's just an amazing multi-genre guy. I'll list off a few groups he's played with. Obviously, he was in Miles Davis's band, Herbie Hancock's, John McLaughlin's, Mick Jagger, Randy Brecker, Willie Nelson, Almond Brothers, Robin Ford. And he fits in beautifully in all those different genres. And he's got Grammys and all that stuff. And tours with Mike Stern and Robin Ford and all those guys. So he's kind of the consummate cross-genre guy. And on top of all that, he's just an incredibly inspirational and gifted jazz educator. So I'm going to hand it over to Don. You can see him on the screen there, so pull up your device and listen, Don. And he's going to play with us with Oscar Perez for a few minutes.
Okay. Thanks, Richard, for that great introduction. Everybody hear me okay? Somebody give me a yes or something.
Oh, yeah.
or no. Great. Okay, it's great when technology actually works. So welcome to my humble home studio in South Orange, New Jersey. I got my great friend and colleague, the wonderful Oscar Perez. And Oscar is the coordinator of jazz studies at Montclair State University, a job which I was honored to have years ago. And he's a worthy successor. He's doing all kinds of great things at Montclair State University, so you can check out their website at montclair.edu if you're curious. It's a great program, and this great young pianist. Well, yes, young still. I give him an extra youthful boost there. Yeah, that's right. So we're going to start off. We play together, and he's in my big funk band, and he's done quite a bit of work with my acoustic quartet as well, so he's part of that family. So we're going to play a few tunes for you duo. We're going to start off with something from my Earth, Wind, and Wonder CD. This is called Don't You Worry About a Thing by Stevie Wonder. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that. We heard it from all. That applause traveled all the way to South Orange. I appreciate you guys so much. We're going to move on now and play something else from Earth, Wind & Wonder. This is another, Earth, Wind & Wonder is one of my current concept projects where we play the music of Earth, Wind & Fire and Stevie Wonder and make it jazz. Jazz being defined as swing, improvisation, all those beautiful things that while the original, like the old standards, the original ones didn't have much improvisation and typically not a lot of swing, even if they had some groove. When we really adapt these songs for jazz, we expand that level of swing, harmony, and then the improvisational side of it so that we, can paint these spontaneous pictures. So we're gonna move on with another tune from that concept from the album. The first one, I have another one in the works, but for now we're still playing stuff from the first one. This is another Stevie Wonder tune that was made famous by Michael Jackson. And this tune from the album Off the Wall is called I Can't Help It, I Can't Help It. We're gonna have Oscar Perez set it up on piano. I'm gonna get the flute out. Thank you. Thank you very much. We're gonna play one more tune, and a quick one, I think, which watching the time. One more time for Oscar Perez on the piano. Thank you very much. And I'm Don Braden on saxophone and flute. Quick thank you to Richard and Colin. Richard, of course, you just met him, and Colin, who you don't see if you're online, he's kind of running the technical aspect of all this. He's awesome. Colin Shook from Monks Jazz Club. You guys are great, so thank you. Thanks to Joe Morales. Thanks to all the kids. They're fantastic. I really loved hearing you guys play, so thank you for that. Big round of applause for all those folks. And one more shout out to Antigua Saxophone Company, who supplies saxophones. R.S. Berkeley gives me flutes. R.S. Berkeley, Antigua for saxophones, Jody Jazz for mouthpieces. I always like to give them a shout out because they give me great equipment, and I'm very, very, very thankful. D'Addario for reeds, too, while I'm at it. I might as well give everybody some shout out. And we're going to play this last tune. This last tune is Alone Together, old standard. We'll play a short version and keep on swinging. Get Bill Evans, who I can't wait to hear in the next segment. Okay, here's Alone Together.
Thank you. Thank you.
One more time for Oscar Perez. Oscar Perez on piano. I'm Don Braden. Thank you all so much. We really appreciate you. Thanks, Richard. Thanks, everybody. Now for the awesome Bill Evans. I'm not sure. I think Colin will take over the transition, and I'll join Bill, and we'll chat a bit.
How are we doing sound-wise?
Okay, give me a second for me to switch the camera.
Sound is good? Awesome. Now, am I supposed to wait for somebody to ask questions? Hey, there you are. Hey, Don.
Is that Bill Evans? Is that Bill Evans in the flesh?
Who's that? Who's that talking? Is that Joe?
Oh, well, of course it is. It's your brother from another mother. And we adopted Bill along the way. So can you hear, guys?
Yes.
Okay.
I can hear everything, yeah.
Yes, I think I can too.
Cool.
Bill, man, I'm so honored to see you.
Well, likewise, and I really enjoyed your performance. That was great.
Thanks, brother. Appreciate that. Good for you. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Oops, there goes the cat. So, so for those that are tuning in, I'm at my home in Nashville, Tennessee. I just moved here a year ago from outside of New York. And how do you want to do this, Don? Do you want me just to start talking, or is there a...
Yeah, brother. This is about you. So do your thing. Okay. If we want to get into a little dialogue about whatever, we can. Particularly if you want to just get some feedback about, you know, just some dialogue about whatever. But otherwise, do your thing, bro.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
All right. I'll just tell you a little bit about my concepts and what I think is important with jazz and what I think helped me the most. Because for me, I tried to figure out when I was coming up what made me sound like a good player. What was the most important thing that I needed to do to sound good? And so I tried to break it down. And I realized that from the very beginning, that it's a language that I need to understand and that I need to have a vocabulary with. And as soon as I realized that, then all of a sudden my playing took a completely different change forward. And this is probably when I was about 15, 16 years old. And I started to play and practice and eliminate lines I thought didn't make sense when I was practicing. And I made a conscious effort. I really made a conscious effort to do that. So I would listen to different saxophone players, and I would try to understand what they're doing, what lines really sounded good, and what lines I might not want to play. I'd write down different lines and stuff. And I looked at this as a language, because it is a language.
Yes,
sir. You know what I mean?
Of course.
So, for instance, I would sit down and I'd say, if I played something like... I'd say, all right, that line works. And I'd write it down because I'm adding another sentence to my vocabulary. I wanted to keep it really simple, but make everything sound good. So I might play another line. I'd say, okay, that's good. And then I'd work all these different things out in different keys. But if I played something that... I'd say, nope.
Nope.
So I'd record it. I'd record myself, and it can just drive you crazy. But I kept doing that, and the more I played just lines that made sense, the more I started to speak the language and sound better and better in a shorter period of time. Because all of a sudden, I'd say I'm playing on a blues, and it's... sudden all my lines are making sense, and I start sounding like an advanced player at a young age. And it's just the clarity of it all, it seemed to simplify it. Like, don't make this harder than it needs to be. So to do that, I'd say, and for you guys listening, I'm going to try to make it as simple as I possibly can to understand and break it down so that it makes sense for everybody that's listening. So For instance, I'd say on a D minor 7, I'm playing obviously on the saxophone. And then I'd play it in all the different keys. But then I thought to myself, if this is a language, I don't want to sound like a robot. You know what I mean? I don't want to get out here and start. If I was talking to everybody and I said, it's really great to see everybody play, you know, and I was totally monotone. I didn't have any expression. You'd say, what's wrong with him? So you don't want to play that way. So I started figuring out, I'll take just a couple phrases, but I want to make them sound as good as possible. So instead of going, that's about as bland as I can make it, right? I started going like, all right, I'm going to emphasize the nuances. And then really exaggerate. So you go, you see what I mean? So it really sounded good. So when I got in front of an audience, if I only played one line that made right in the beginning, but I came out with a good sound and I went, immediately people, it sounds okay. It sounds like, you know, you can play. And I didn't play that much. And for instance, I remember some of the early concerts with Miles Davis. And I remember he'd walk out on stage and the audience was in awe anyway. I was in awe. We were good friends at that period, you know, but he'd grab his trumpet, right? And he'd look at the audience and he'd just go, and then he'd just kind of look away. And the audience would freak out, completely freak out. He played three notes, but those notes sounded great. It's like, you know what I mean? And it was keeping it simple, but really strong. Because for young players, you want to really think about the lines you're playing. For as long as you play your instrument, you're going to want to increase your vocabulary. That's what I'm going to, even after this clinic tonight, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to practice. And I'm always trying to increase my vocabulary, trying to play more, trying to say more, trying to free myself up. So when you're practicing, because our brains are not as slick as we think they are, play things slowly, you know, and deliberately, and make them sound good, you know. And put some feeling into it, you know what I mean? And that way, you're going to sound good right before you're even into the first part of your solo. It's like someone go. It's like, for instance, when you're giving a, if someone's giving a speech, right? And these are the things I would learn from standing on stage with all these different great musicians. And Don, I'm sure you have the same experiences, and the same for young players playing with you as well, to where they get the audience's attention. And they start out slowly. It's like they're telling a secret. You know what I mean? If someone's telling a secret and gets somebody up there and says, you're not going to believe what I heard, everybody's going to stop and listen. Right. And so it's like, you know, if you come in with your solo and they say, let's say you're playing on giant steps, right? And you come in and go, slowly, you're telling a little bit of a story, right? But if you come in there, people are going to go, wow, it's really cool. Now where the hell are you going to go? You better burn so hard for the next 30 minutes, and that's going to be pretty hard to do. So emphasize, emulate, put color into it, you know? And I don't have the piano up here for just a prop, as much as it could be. But you want to just, instead of having a bland chord like a... Right? I mean, it's not a marching band. So you want to do like... And you go, that sounds good. What the hell did you do? Well, let's say on piano, it's a D minor to G to C. That's a 2-5-1. You could spend years learning 2-5-1s and apply the concept to so many different tunes. And I know Don is you play the heck out of it. I mean, it's like I could hear you going in and out of it, melodic and all the synchronized playing and everything. So, you know, you really understand this language, obviously, and I've been a fan of yours for years and years. So what I'm trying to tell the guys is you make the 5 chord is your color chord. So the G, instead of playing, you could almost play anything. You could almost play in the D minor. Then for the G, I'll play an A flat. But make sure you resolve it. That's one of the tricks. Make sure you resolve it. And the reason I'm telling you that story, not just because it's a cool story, but is Miles used to tell me stories like that, where he said he'd be standing on stage and Bird would play outside the chord for 20 choruses. He wouldn't play, you know, until the last 4 bars, and then he'd land on the tonic, on what the chord actually was. So he was constantly putting this tension, and or sometimes play 2 beats in front of what the chord actually was,
right,
for chorus after chorus. I mean, that's insane. But what I'm trying to say is you want to add color. You know what I mean? We're not robots. So that's it, I can use my soprano. So you want to add emphasize that, you know? So when I heard everybody play, so much talent. I really enjoyed that. Really, I want to thank everyone for performing tonight because that was really cool. And for all the players, it's the same for everybody. We're always trying to add to our playing. And I like the dynamics everybody played with too. All the players and tenor players, piano, drums, everybody. I mean, it was really nice dynamics. So you guys are doing the right thing. But it never hurts to just keep exaggerating these things, you know? And when you're playing through these lines, try to make variations, you know. Let's say you have a simple line. You could also go, or making sure every line makes sense. I mean, you have like, if you have a 2-5-1 that's, hard for me to remember what I'm playing. And then you could just keep making variations on that. You know? And the more you can sort of disguise your own limitations to the audience, which means playing with confidence and having a nice vocabulary, the more fun it is. It's really more fun the more lines you know. And there's a myth that I always try to tell people. People will say, oh, I don't want to be a lick player. Well, that's a fallacy. If you're trying to learn a language, let's say you're trying to learn French, and someone says, all right, I want you to read in French. I want you to read these phrases. And you say, oh, no, because if you show me how to say it's sunny outside, that's all I'm going to say in French. No, it isn't. You see, you learn these sentences, as many as you possibly can. And guess what? They all blend together. And then you'll play it your own way. And then you come out. That's what ends up happening. Don't ever be afraid of that. You want to learn phrases, and I call those sentences, as many as you possibly can. They're not going to hurt you. They're just going to add to your repertoire. And another thing, which is really interesting to do, is when you listen to different players, and there's a lot of great players out there, try to emulate them. Try to figure out what you think they're doing. And that way, you'll be able to add just a little bit of something to your own playing. I used to listen to Joe Henderson all the time live, and he used to just fly around the horn, and his style was very loose. So it was like, so he'd go like, you know, like that. And I'm thinking, okay, he wasn't tapping his foot or anything. He was just, there were no bar lines. He was just kind of playing through like a blues. He'd be like, and so I started to think, okay, how could I do that and add to what I do? So I would try to play like that. I don't want to be a Joe Henderson guy, but I want to understand how he said it, how he said his phrases. And then, you know, and Train would be, John Coltrane would be much more intense. You know, it'd be like, or if I heard him go, I had to figure out what that was. I mean, it drove me nuts. I would ask Dave Liebman, I would ask Michael Brecker, I would ask all the post-Coltrane guys, how do you go? And then they just play it, go, well, it was a harmonic thing. I would overblow, and I'm going, well, show me. But eventually, it just becomes sort of part of your playing. But I'd analyze all these guys, so I understood their language. I was never going to speak their language, but I wanted to understand their language. It's like if I were saying, it's really nice to be here, ladies and gentlemen. It's London's one of my favorite places. And it's like, you know, it's just a style. It's just like a different way of playing. But all that adds to your instrument. All that adds to what you do. So if you just got in your room and you just learned a couple phrases, but you made them sound really, really good. Like you went, and you just sat and you made sure that that sounded great. That style of making that line sound great is what you would do on all the other lines until you incorporate that into what you do. You see what I mean? So that's the kind of stuff that I always thought about, especially when I was playing, that seemed to make, you know, the biggest difference in what I did. And this is what I'm playing here is an aluminum mouthpiece. It's a Bill Evans signature mouthpiece. We've been putting one out, a brass one, which is very expensive, almost $2,000. But now we're making the same one in aluminum, which is going to be much more expensive. I think it's going to be $4.99 or $5.99 because it doesn't take as long in the machine to make it, but it still gets a great sound. I play it all the time. Anyway, that's kind of the main thing that I wanted to speak about. Is there anything, Don, that you think that I could touch on? Or?
Sure, plenty of things. Talk a little bit about, first off, thank you for that. That was really some cool ideas and very insightful. So maybe just off of that,
yeah.
A couple things I'd like to just have you get a little more specific about, just
sure.
especially for some of the younger people who might be watching,
absolutely.
Who might want to get specifically into this. You said makes sense and sounds good, right?
Yeah.
And so those are subjective.
Yeah,
subjective
that's true.
Things.
That's very true.
And so how can students self-assess better? Because that's one of the most important things I've found. And what you're talking about is definitely an exercise in self-assessment. And
yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about more how you assess yourself?
Yes. And what I mean by that, and that's a great question, because that does that always needs to be clarified, I think, a little bit more. I would say when you're learning how to play, bebop is such an integral part of the language. It is the language. From that language, you can say anything. Like when Richard mentioned, and I've known Richard for, I think, over 40 years. And the funny thing is, me or Richard haven't changed. We look exactly the same as we did. Anyway.
Love it.
Anyway.
Some other questions. How do you do that?
Yeah. Okay, what do I think sounds good? Okay, take bebop lines. Learn bebop lines. And so, you know, you'd know if a bebop line sounds good. Try to play phrases. They're in books. There's so many learning things. There's so many ways of learning those. Use those as your sort of your base. Those are the lines that sound good. And record yourself.
I thought you might say that, because I think I tell my students all the time to record themselves, and I record myself.
Me
just
too.
Just, as a matter of self-assessment, that's one of the big ones, I think.
Oh, it is, yeah. And sometimes just think, okay, let's say you're playing on Record-A-May or any of the tunes that they played, you know, tonight, and just try to, and maybe break it down when you're rehearsing. And maybe just consciously not get into it. You know, you don't, like when you're playing out in a club or with people, you can get into it and feel and be inspired. But when you're practicing, you could sort of like be conscious of, now I'm practicing. I'm going to be learning something, you know.
Right.
And say, okay, I'm going to play on Record-A-May, but the first line, I'm going to make sure that every line I play on this, I'm going to try to have it make sense and sound good. So you might go... and say, okay, I think that sounds good. And sometimes it may not be the best line, but if you think in that way, like you're trying to make sure that these lines make sense, you're on the right track, I think. You know, then you might play the next line if you say, you might say, okay, that's okay. Or you might go, that's better, you know. I would say just bebop lines are the ones that I would say were the ones that sound the best. And try to make sure that those are the ones you incorporate and you're putting in. Because the more time you spend as a young player noodling around aimlessly, trying to play, and you'll play a couple good lines and then you're spending a lot of time searching, I think you could do better with your time by stopping and going, okay. Because that helped me the most. That's where... Between when I was in college, I went at North Texas State my freshman year. In a four-month period doing that, I made the biggest leap that I ever made by doing that. And instructors and other students were saying the same thing. Wow, what are you doing different? You're playing, and it was like, that's what it was.
So you were learning bebop lines. You were learning them from listening to them and also from like the Omni book or whatever, like all the different...
Yes, all that stuff. And at that time, I was listening to a lot of Sonny Stitt. I was listening to a lot of Sonny Rollins.
Those guys.
And I would pick out lines. And when I'd hear Sonny Rollins, I'd say, okay, I'm going to try to play lines like him. So I wouldn't play it like Joe Henderson. I'd go like, you know, his way of articulation.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And then you go.
Right.
You know, and I try to do it like that. And then I would start to really get a grip of what I thought he was feeling when he was playing, at least what I thought. Right. And then that would make my playing a little stronger. But if you think in terms of trying to not just noodle around and guess, and listen, when we perform and we play, I mean, I can do hours of that, you know, but to get to the point where you have enough lines to where, you know, at that point, you can do that. I think you really need to spend the time as a student getting as many lines as possible and increasing your vocabulary.
Totally. I mean, and that's all part of all of us professionals. These are professionals that play in the style. I mean, the ones of us who really dig into changes and play in these styles that are really connected to the bebop, you know, standards legacy. We did that work. We have to. You have to.
Yeah, you have to. To learn the language. And it's funny because, excuse me, you can play, once you learn how to play, and I say bebop, you don't have to worry about, well, I'm just going to be a bebop musician. I'll never be able to play with anybody else.
No.
Gives you the opportunity to play any kind of music.
Totally.
Because, I mean, I remember asking Mick Jagger years ago, I was doing a record of his, and he said, and I said, Why do you always call jazz musicians to do certain solos and stuff? He says, because those are the musicians that can play. That's what he said. He said, I get those because they're the ones that can really play. Yeah, you know, I mean, it's, you know, I could do this line. I could do that in a rock band, a soul band, a funk band.
Right.
You know.
Right.
I could do that with Rob Thomas at Madison Square Garden. I could do that with Coldplay. I could do that with, I could do that at the Blue Note in New York, you know.
Right. Right.
I could do that with anybody. It's just, it's all inflections, you know.
Right.
And I've given this sort of talk for a lot of well-known, not to be named, guitar players that say, man, I want to be able to say more on my instrument. And I'll say, okay, so you made enough money, so now you want to actually really know how to play. But I would talk about just what we're talking about now.
Right.
Bebop phrases, all the bebop phrases that made sense to incorporate into the playing.
Yeah.
And by doing that, they could do that over a rock song. And now they can, instead of going like, and I've met horn players in the past where they're just, let's say they're playing like, they consider themselves a rock saxophone player. To me, rock saxophone player means someone that didn't put the time in to really learn how to play their instrument. I mean, I'm not trying to be harsh, but if someone can go, but has to stick to like the blues scale, you're dying for them to go. You know. You're like, man,
at least
playing.
At least we are. I mean, you know, it's really funny that in our kind of, let's say in the U.S. at least, the musical perception kind of environment is not one that craves such high level, it seems.
Right.
You know, I say that kind of politically correctly because I'm not an expert, but I haven't studied it. I'm just going anecdotally. But from my experience,
right.
You know, certain situations, people do want you to lock in. And it's particularly comes producers. I know you know what I'm talking about. Certain producers will not let you. You try to put some slick stuff in there, and they go, no, none of that slick stuff. They want a couple notes.
Right,
you know,
right.
You've worked with those guys. You know what I'm talking about.
Oh, of course. Of course. Well, I mean, fortunately enough, I've been fortunate to play with bands where if I'm called to do something, and I mostly just play cold-head bands in my own band for the last 40 years, but it's...
But they call you, then they know they're getting you.
Yeah, and if it gets into that other thing, I'll say, man, you maybe need to call somebody that's going to
sure. want of course. You to do but that. But band leaders won't call you for that. It's mostly those like certain kinds of business characters more than musical.
Oh, absolutely. Music. Absolutely. You know? But, you know, it's... For all the kids that are learning jazz and everything, and I know you could second this, the more you know, the better you totally. Play, the more fun totally. You have.
Totally.
I mean, you were having a ball playing. I mean, when I was always. Watching you play, always. I was so inspired to play. I wish I had a piano player here to play because now I'm dying to play. You got me so inspired to play.
Well, yeah, let's do, make sure we do what Richard's hearing this, so we'll do that again for sure. Count on it.
That would count be fun. That would be totally fun.
Do it. And as soon as you and I can get together, we'll definitely do that. But I have another question for you.
Yeah.
And then we're going to get to the kids. We got I'm looking at the clock okay. now. So, but I want to ask one, and thank you for answering that. That's great. So, you know, lots of insights and lots of ideas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think everybody I know teaches and plays, listen, imitate.
Yeah, absolutely.
Practice, learn language, man. And books are cool, but listening in connection, if you learn something from a book, try to find the recording that goes with it that way.
Oh, I got to tell you. And I'm glad you touched on that because short period of time, I can't touch on everything. Right. For me, when I was coming up, I spent just as much time listening as practicing.
Of course.
I mean, same. I was obsessed. Same. And I would realize I was a Sonny Stitt fanatic and I was able to take some lessons with him when I was a kid.
Oh, great.
He would come to Chicago. I'd take the train down and I'd meet him at the Maryland Hotel before he played the Jazz Showcase.
Wow.
71, 72,
wow.
73.
Wow.
Before all, most of you students were there.
Me too.
But like, you know, he'd go... You know, he showed me that, which is on his tune-up record, right? And everything was smooth, everything was burning, everything was just terrible. Really together. But I'd listen. It was like Sonny Stitt, Stan Getz, Charlie Parker, even though I was playing tenor.
Right.
And the more I listened, the more those lines would come out the way they should. The more the language made sense to me. Right. Which is why, for instance, when you have Berlitz and all these different these different things, they say if you want to learn a language, listen. Well, your brain doesn't know the difference between jazz and learning Italian. It doesn't. It's the same mechanism. So if you got up every single day and you were listening for 20 minutes, let's say you listen to Charlie, whoever you like, you know, if you're a piano player, if you listen to piano or whatever, and you did it every day, those lines would start to come out.
Just come out. Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up.
So that's one thing. The last thing I want to ask you before I turn over to the kids is, because I think this is a very important thing that you touched on with the 2-5-1, and you kind of went quickly through it, but I want you to spend a couple minutes.
Sure.
The magical five chord, man. The five chord is the key to life.
It's everything.
In linear harmony, which to me, bebop is about the linearization of harmony. That's what bebop is.
Right.
That's what makes it so special. So when you learn bebop, you can linearize harmony in any style. So then it just comes down to just what you're saying. It just comes down to whatever the inflections are and the type of tune and key and tempo and whatever blends and stuff. But depending on what the group dynamic is, but the linearization of harmony is like the really special thing that bebop completely codifies for us to really. And they cats have done it. All we got to do is learn and understand the concepts and find our own way to speak that language, and then we've that skill of linearizing harmony. So the question I want you to just dig into a little deeper for a hot second for everyone is that five chord, because a five, man, is just everything. You get your fives going, you got gold.
Well, I look at the five chord, that's the color chord. That's what's going to give it the personality.
Absolutely.
And you can do whatever you want with that five chord. I mean, literally, and my big thing when I would try to explain it to people, and I even talked about this with Miles because I was really curious about how he felt about that, because we had a lot of time to sit and hang and talk, and I wish I remembered all the discussions we used to have about that stuff. But sometimes I'd say, well, no, if you change a five chord and you alter it and it, you know, you add the color and then it comes back, and then he'd look at me and go, yeah, that's good. You know, it's just like, okay. But yeah, I mean, let's say on a, you know, and then the G, you can go the two chord, and then the five chord, you can make the color part. Instead of going, you could go. And then kids will go, I have no idea what he just did.
Right.
The way I would, when I was coming up, is I'd say, instead of playing on the G7, I'll just go up a half step, and I'll play like, and the A-flat 7, but I'll make sure I resolve it. So and I remember asking Jay Mabersall this when I was a kid.
Yeah, right.
And he could go, yeah, well, Bill, that's a possibility.
Yes. That's what sounds like.
But so it'd be like, so I would practice slowly. And then. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, that's you're right. Five chord is the personality, the color. It's the planet. It's the galaxy. It's the constellation. It's like.
Yeah, I think the as far as the students go, I think the good starting point. So G7, you're in G7, right? So D minor G7 C, right? So G7, that's your five. You go A flat 7, so you're gonna spice it up right away. You're a half step away, and my favorite is D flat 7, which is almost the same thing, basically.
Well, no, actually, it's probably more D flat 7 is what I think, the way I think of it, sort of like a G half diminished, or G diminished whole tone, or
which is kind of like a D flat 7. Right.
But I would try to break it down to the point where I didn't want to think diminished cycloinvadian xylidian diaphragm.
I
thought,
right.
Okay,
exactly.
I'm just going
to
go
the nomenclature, get to the gobbledygook, and it's like, wait, I don't want to, you know.
Because I always want to keep it simple, because the bottom line is what I want to sound good in front of an audience. What do I need to do to sound as good as I possibly can and keep it as simple as I can in my brain?
Right.
So I would kind of do things like that, but yeah.
But D flat, so D flat 7 implies in D flat pentatonic, D flat, if you want to go D flat.
I'm all over. That's the best.
All of the D flat triads, your D flat,
love
E flat
that.
triad pair, all these possibilities that jump into.
Those are great.
Yeah.
Great. And I still think about those. I'll always think about those. You know, I mean, it just adds the color. It's just so great for playing, you know.
Right. But you said the key thing, and I want to reiterate that, and then we'll kick it over to the kids. So Colin, stand by for that. But the key thing is resolving it.
Yeah, you have to resolve it.
Realizing that that color cord, that your tension and release, like you already talked about it. So the tension side of it, the whole point of the five chords is to build that tension, which adds a spice, which makes the release that much more satisfying, which would then lead to the next tension, etc. And that's what that creates motion in the music. And you can hear it in chords, but it's certainly hard to, not hard, but it's a skill, I should say. It's not hard per se, but it's a skill to linearize that.
Right. And absolutely.
If you do it, it's way hipper. And that's the key.
Yeah, and playing it slow. And the more a person, student, whoever, plays it slowly, the more the brain remembers it.
Absolutely.
Because I remember I used to try to play as fast as I could, and I realized if I slowed everything way down, I'd remember it, and then it would be that much easier to play faster. But I'd slow everything down, and I'd compartmentalize everything, and when I'd practice, okay, I'm going to do this now, now I'm going to do this now, now I'm going to do this now. And I'd be consciously thinking about it. I'm not just going in there noodling for half an hour and then leaving. All that's going to do is help the muscle in my lip, but it's not going to help my playing.
Yeah, exactly. And it's fun, but not necessarily productive. It can be fun.
Yeah, and there's a time for that.
There's a time for that, too, of course.
But, yeah, exactly.
Bill, bro.
Yeah, fantastic. Done.
We have to do more of this.
Absolutely. More. Love it.
So we'll make sure to do that.
I love passing on anything I've learned.
Yeah, no,
because I learned from doing it.
Well, welcome to our world, bro. That's it.
Yeah, right.
That's our world. So, Colin, let's get some students. I know they probably have a couple questions with this stuff as well. So I hope you guys have been thinking about questions because we want you to ask them. So let's see what he's going to do. There comes somebody. There's nice students lined up.
Hey. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, Margo, fantastic. Awesome. I was just wondering, Bill, what goes through your head when you're soloing? Because obviously there's a lot going on, but are there specific things that you like focus on when you're soloing? Or is it just having fun?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I love it when there are some nights where it just feels like it's not a body experience and you're just playing, but that doesn't happen all the time. So I try to tell a story. I try to take it slow. I try not to play everything I know in the first chorus, you know. I try to pretend like I start here and I end over here, you know, and then hopefully I can make it as interesting as possible. It doesn't happen all the time, you know. I mean, there are times when the saxophone feels like, you know, a piece of hardware that should go in my garage, you know, and it's a fight. But that's John McLaughlin used to tell me, that John McLaughlin, the guitarist, used to say the beauty in the fight. And there is something in that because when it feels really difficult, you're actually getting better. You're actually getting up the plateau. There'll be a point where your horn playing or whatever instrument, piano, drums, it doesn't matter.
Voice.
Yeah, it starts to feel, it'll feel really good, and then it'll start feeling really bad and you work on it. Well, that's when you actually take it up a notch. You're going up a plateau every time, and that's how that works. And by practicing all the time, playing with as many live people as you possibly can, and thinking about the things we're talking about, that gets you to that next plateau. But if there's something I focused on, like right now, and I'm going to play, is have a start of the solo and be able to go somewhere. And sometimes I won't know. I mean, I might just be playing on something and I won't know where I'm going to go. I'll start slowly. I don't know where I'm going to go, you know. And then just see what happens. Just as a starting point, if I was completely blank, it's like, what am I thinking about? But it's really cool when you can feel like your brain is connected to your fingers and it's skipping your conscious brain and you're just going. And Don knows what I'm talking about.
That's the best.
So it's like, and it's something that you're just, when it happens, you feel amazing. Like when you're out there in front of a crowd and that one, and you're playing a solo and all of a sudden everything just comes together, you know? Me and Robin Ford, the guitarist, we did a tour in July in Europe, and we were playing in Montreux, and I was getting over the flu. I thought I had COVID. It wasn't COVID. It was the flu. And that particular night, it was a sold out, a pretty big place, and just the saxophone, my mind was somewhere else and just felt everything was just flowing, you know, just, and I was like, oh God, this feels so good. And we're just always waiting and counting on that hour, that 15 minutes, that, you know, it's all for that.
Yeah.
But when it happens, it's unbelievable,
yeah.
You know, and you guys are all on the way to doing that, you know. I mean, I'm hearing some great solos, trumpet, tenor, alto, piano. I mean, you guys sound great. And Margo, your singing was great. I mean, you really have a great
Thanks.
Feel. Just keep doing what you're doing. So you guys, just keep increasing your vocabulary. Just keep adding to it. Don't stop doing that. And eventually, you think like, don't worry about what's my style going to be. It's going to eventually just happen. You, whoever you are, it's going to happen. You know, don't worry about if you're listening to whoever that you're going to play just like that guy. You never will. No. You know, who you are is going to come out. Anyway, I went off on a tangent. But.
Yeah, good question, good answer. Who's next?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I had a question about composing, specifically with chords and whatnot. I guess it's kind of a broad question, and I'm sorry if it's too hard to answer, but like, how do you like truly understand how chords work and how they move together? Because sometimes I feel like I'll be sitting on my computer trying to figure out like a good chord progression, and I feel like I'm just not getting anywhere.
Mm-hmm. That's well, you know what I would do? If you're looking at a chord progression, trying to figure it out, look for common tones. That always helps. You know what I mean? If you're sitting, it could be like, you know, I just played a D throughout the whole thing. So that would actually be one way to try to make sense out of chord progressions, you know, or try to play a simple line that works, that you can kind of play on all of them. You know, you could go, just to try to get into it. A short phrase, just a few notes, you know, it could be like, you know what I mean? And just, you know, and you could even just kind of, and sometimes what I'll do if the chord progressions are going really fast, and I'll use giant steps as an example, you could play half notes. So you go, you know what I mean? Just to try to do something different that makes sense, that make a little more sense than just going, and it'll make you understand it more. The minute you start finding common tones in the different chords, in a series of chords, it starts to make more sense. It really does. And for composing, what's that? Yeah.
No, it's just, that's a great, I love, you know, the idea of taking a song that you already know and looking for logic, linear logic within the chord progression that you already know to approach it from the other side, right? That's what Bill's basically saying to you. It's like you can look for common tones in a chord progression you already know, or find a line of half steps up or down, or some kind of logical simple phrase, a repeated theme or whatever,
yeah,
that takes you through the chord progression. That helps you make sense of the logic of the chord progression that you already know.
Yeah.
You can kind of take that and extrapolate. Is that what you're saying, Bill?
Yeah, exactly. Because what you want to do is you just want to, there's no mystery in any of this stuff.
In a way.
You know what I mean? It's like anybody, you know, anybody can play jazz if they just look at it like a language, you know, and that's what it is. So if you see a daunting chord progression, break it down and it'll start to make sense, you know. You could go like, wow, I can go like, you know, all of a sudden that could have been over a chord progression that you were like, I'm not really sure here. Or you could even do like a chromatic thing. You know, you can do anything in there. And you could find a million different possibilities as far as doing that. That's what I do. Whenever I see like, I did a tune, Manu Cachet, Daryl Jones, and Niels Landoki. We did some gigs in Denmark. And some of the chord changes were, when I first saw them, when I was first playing on them, they didn't relate. And so I was trying to like figure out. And the first thing I did was realize the 3, 4, 5 notes that tied all these chord changes together. And I could play a solo around those three, four, or five notes, and the whole thing would work. So break, keep it simple and look at it that way. Don't look at it as like a whole set of chord changes and what am I going to do? Break it down, mystery over.
So then, yeah. But the question was also about composition, right? So then okay. You flip it over, take the same concept you're talking about, and then flip it over so that when it's time to write something, your understanding of chords through playing these other kinds of tunes and decoding, because that's the key. The key is to, it's going to be hard to figure out chord progressions for composition if you haven't already studied lots of chord progressions and done exactly what Bill's talking about.
Yeah, I mean, it's always great to know piano. I mean, I started on piano. But I mean, when I write, I play on piano, and sometimes it's hard for me. I'll write a tune that doesn't sound good on saxophone, and if I'm going to record something, I can't do it because I'll write this tune that doesn't really lay well on a saxophone, and so it's kind of difficult. But I'm trying to write more on a saxophone and then put chords to it. But yeah, I mean, I get an idea and I'll just sit at a piano and just start trying to figure it out, you know? And sometimes I don't know what's going to come out. You know what I mean? It could be just, you know. You know, I'll think, oh, that's kind of cool. And then I might go.
Right, right.
You know, and then I'll write that down and work on it tomorrow. And then it might turn out to be. Actually, that was kind of hip. See, I'm writing something like that.
Well, anyway, recording but. If I can play back the recording and check it out.
But, yeah, I mean, start slow. Sometimes I'll just use one note on my left hand and one note on my right. So it could be like, you know. Whatever, and I can fill in the chords later. And sometimes a tune will just write itself and you don't even know where it came from, you know? I mean, I sat at the piano once with Miles and we played, we're sitting there and he goes. And I went, yeah, Nardis. And he goes, yeah, great tune by Bill Evans. Right. But he got credit for it everywhere, but Bill Evans wrote that tune.
Right.
And he said it was great the way the notes were like, you know, a half step apart. And when we wrote a bunch of tunes that we didn't end up recording, it was a very interesting lesson because let's say we had a melody that was, and I'm making it up now, let's say something was. He'd say, all right, take away some of the middle notes. So it'd be. And I don't know if those are the real notes. And then he'd go, yeah, take some more out. So it'd be. And he'd go, take out a few more, we're close. And so then it'd be. And then sometimes it would be. You know, and we'd break it down to be this hip little melody with space. And we do that to every one of them. And it was so cool. And then I started realizing some of the tunes that he would write in his life. He was kind of doing that concept. And I'd never heard anybody say that. So, you know, it was like. Would be. You know, and then. All of a sudden, you say, yeah, you got to give the band a chance to play, get the rhythm section involved. And then you have the chance for the piano player to fill in with a, you know, and interesting writing concept, something to think about, you know. I don't think I've actually ever mentioned that to anybody until now.
Super
interesting.
Cool.
Anyway.
Cool.
Thank you. That was super helpful.
Oh, cool. We're here to help.
I just wanted to ask, what was the greatest lesson you learned from, or most valuable lesson you learned from Miles Davis?
Most valuable lesson. You know what the most valuable lesson is? And it's almost like a curse, but it's a lesson. To have confidence in what you do. Believe in what you do. See the end result of what you want to do no matter what anybody, whatever's happening on both sides of you, believe in it. I mean, I've done all kinds of music in my different bands, and mostly I've toured these in Europe forever. It just happened to be the way it is and still is. But he just said, whatever music you believe in that you feel, that's what you do. Because then if you believe in it, then so will the audience. And I mean, that's why I had my Soulgrass band for 10 years, which was banjo, mandolin, violin, really great players. And we do this sort of bluegrass or inflected tunes, but it sounded like bebop. You know, when someone would ask me about bluegrass, I don't know anything about bluegrass. I never listened to bluegrass. I don't know anything. I don't even know any players, you know. Wow. But I like the sound of those instruments.
I'm from Kentucky. You know that, right?
What's that?
I'm from Kentucky.
Well, then you know.
I grew up with bluegrass. Totally.
Yeah, right. I'm the opposite. I mean, I grew up in Chicago, so it was like...
Ah.
But anyway, so that was the lesson. And he told me that. Before I did my first record, he said, don't be pressured, you know, and it's a luxury to be able to do that, you know, I mean, at the time, but or any time, but whatever music you're hearing, don't be afraid to do that. That's what you need to do. That was the biggest, to be myself, because if I wanted to be like Miles Davis, that's not like being myself. That's like being like Miles Davis. So he said, be yourself and believe in what you do. And he told me, he said, that's what Wayne Shorter did. That's what Herbie Hancock did. And he was just listing the guys, you know, Coltrane. That's what Coltrane did. He said everybody went their own path and they believed in what they did. And that's not to say it's going to be easy. It's never easy, but it's better that way. I mean, not everybody's going to like it. But not everybody's going to like anything anyway. So if you have fun playing what you're going to play and you believe in what you're doing, hey, man, it's home run.
Love that, man.
Sure.
Ian, you have a question?
Yeah. Hi. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, I was just wondering, this is kind of a saxophone-specific thing. So I noticed you, I think, if I'm not mistaken, you play on a vintage Mark VI soprano and same with the tenor, am I right?
Right.
I was just wondering why you chose those horns over maybe like more modern instruments or even older stuff. I was just wondering why.
I just think of Mark VI for me. I mean, I've played other instruments and there's some great instruments out there. Don's playing an instrument that, you know, whatever works for you, you're playing an instrument that feels great. I mean, it's all relative to what feels great for you. For me, the soprano always, this Mark VI always felt really good to me. I've tried Yamahas. They're great instruments. I've tried Yanagisawas. Those are great instruments. They're in tune. They feel good. To me, this is like a speed stick, you know? I've been comfortable with it for a million years. I mean, my sound, this is a Dukoff D8. I don't play with a real loud sound. I like a really warm sound, so when I'm playing... I have a DPA mic system that the microphone goes right up to about here. So it's a real... You know, I like a really warm sound, and for me, this Mark VI does it for me. But there's so many great horns out there. It doesn't have to be. And this is a 62,000... Mark VI from like 1957, I think it is. And it just feels good. I've played other horns that are better and I've tried to convince them that I need to trade with them and they won't. But
the horns don't let you.
Yeah, yeah. No, there's, I got a friend who has about 50 of these and there's one I really want. I'm still trying to get it. But
oh, you're trying to get them to sell to you, me? Or give it to you or whatever?
No. Dan Reinstein, who's a really famous eye surgeon in London, is a friend of mine, and he's got well over 100 Mark VIs.
No kidding.
And,
wow.
Yeah, and he's got a bunch. But for me, I just like the old Mark VIs. It's just something that's always worked for me. I've never been one to really get into the equipment. You know, I'm always concentrating on what I'm playing all the time, so I never really got into it. Only the mouthpiece thing. I like this mouthpiece we're going to be putting out, I think, is super easy to play, and most reeds work on it. Like 2.5, 3.5. So it's something I think that's going to really help a lot of young musicians. Yeah, that's a good technical. Yeah, you're Ian, right?
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah, you got a great sound. I like your playing a lot.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, man, it sounds beautiful.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you keep doing what you're doing. Keep adding to vocabulary like the rest of us and just keep getting into it, and you'll be fine.
Thank you.
All you guys.
This is my other Antigua, Bill. This one's made by Peter Ponzel.
Oh, wow.
And this one's got all kinds of interesting...
Wow, that's beautiful.
Isn't that crazy?
That's really beautiful.
This is actually my favorite tenor. I'm playing the other one because I got to make a video about it for the company, which is also really good. You can hear I really love it, but I love this one even more.
Wow.
But these guys make really good horns, and they're kind of like Mark VI's, but they're just modern. And so all I wanted to add to what you said was that, like, which is pretty the same thing, just seconding it, really, that in the end, it's really about the player and practice and your sound you hear in your head and your voice and what makes you get to that. So for me, this horn helps me get the most quickly and efficiently to my currently.
Yeah.
For me, this Antigua, this is a Pro 1 Antigua. And this particular one, for me, just I play, I was like, wow, this is it. And it's awesome. Personal. It's like a car or like a jacket or like a good friend. You know, it's the choice of instrument, as long as it's good quality, professional quality, if you're playing it all the time. Then it's personal within that, and that's so Yamahas play the way they play, and I've had some Mark VI's, some good ones and some less good ones, but a really good instrument.
And not all Mark VI's are great. Don't play well. I've sold a whole bunch of horns that I've had for years and years and years that I would play occasionally, and I thought if I haven't played them in 10, 15, 20 years, someone else would play them. But
yeah, just sell them, sure.
Yeah, and I sold a whole bunch. I still have some in the closet right here. But I mean, I tried to play for me, I've been playing this for so long, you know, it's like a glove. And I tried to learn how to play a Yamaha, which is a great horn, and they had a silver one, silver plated. And I went in New York, and they were trying to shape it for my fingers. And I wanted that to work so bad because it was such a pretty horn, you know. And we tried it so many times, I'm like, and then I would just mine, and I, you know, like, I'm like, oh, man. You know, I even brought the silver one to Europe to do a couple concerts, and it just wasn't my horn. I felt like I was waiting to play my horn, so I had to tell him, I'm sorry, I really regret that I can't play this instrument because it's so gorgeous. But
I've had a few different horns over the years, and what I found, it takes about a year to almost two to really get to the point where where it feels comfortable like that. So you can't get it in a couple months or something like that, unless it speaks to you right away. But even so, it takes a year to break them, especially a new horn, a year to even break them in, physically break them in.
Exactly.
But
there's so many, I mean, people have so many choices now. There's so many good horns.
Sure.
You know, like coming up, it was basically just a Yamaha Khan or a Selmer. That was about it.
That's it. Back in the day.
Yep. And they were not as expensive as they are now.
Hey, guys, we have time for one more question. Okay. Thank you, guys.
Sure.
Hello.
Who's asking it?
Who or what made you realize you wanted to pursue music for the rest of your life?
Who or what?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I never thought about it, ever. And I always did sports as well, but I always did music. It's funny. I'd get up in the morning. I'd go to school early. I'd play my horn for about a half an hour. Go to school, lunch, go play my horn again for half an hour. Then I'd either go like to wrestling practice or whatever, go home, play for 2 hours. I mean, I did this every day in high school, eighth grade. And then in college, I was practicing all the time. But that's, you know, there's a time when you have to do that. That's the time you do it. When you guys are young, now is the time. And, you know, and it's like you want to prepare yourself so that when you get an opportunity, you're ready for that opportunity. Because when I got this call, which changed my life, to play in front of Miles Davis, I never thought that as an option. I was living in New York. I was 21, and I was just going to hear as many people as I could. James Williams was a good friend of mine, and I'd sit in with Art Blakey. I'd sit in with different people as best I could. And you just want to practice and be ready in case you get an opportunity to play with somebody. And when I got a call from him to come and play with him, to audition, you could say, he stood right next to me and he said, get out your soprano. And he had Bobby Irving, who was in his nephew's band there with a keyboard. He said, Bobby, play a blues. And then he's standing there like this. And now here's the guy that stood next to every major jazz saxophonist in the last 100 years that made a huge difference in, you know. So I'm not going to play anything that's going to, you know, I'm not going to shock. I'm not doing anything he hasn't heard. So I just want to play as good as I can, because this is the one, everything I've ever done, practiced every hour for those years, is coming down to this opportunity. And I don't really remember what I played, but I got into it. And I remembered the things we're talking about. I took my time. And then Miles stops us and he says, if I were to play saxophone, I'd like to play just like you. And I said, wow, thanks. He goes, so let's get something to eat. Congratulations. And cool. and I like went, as the sweat was like covering my eyes, I'm going like, oh God. And he says, it's going to be fun to play, to you know, start doing some playing together. And I went back to my loft with other musicians and I was like, oh my God, I can't believe this, you know? But suppose I didn't have it together enough, whatever, and I started playing and he said, well, thanks for coming by, I'll see you later. I would have been crushed for life thinking I had this opportunity. So, I mean, you never know when that's gonna happen. So you just wanna have fun, make the instrument as fun as you possibly can, learn these things we're talking about. If you have a chance to work with Don, I mean, Don knows all this information. Everything I'm talking about, Don knows it backwards and forwards. You're very fortunate. So it's like, so that when you get an opportunity to sit in with somebody or to play with somebody, or even guys in your town that can really play, you're ready to do it. You know what I mean? You're ready for that opportunity. So that's a good question.
Yeah, man. Well, I would say that whatever I can bring to the table is cool, but I'm very super, super happy and proud to have shared the Zoom adventure with you. We can't wait to get you in person. Well, not other Zooms, of course, but if we can't wait to get you in person to Texas to,
oh, absolutely,
to hang with us, man, and do some more, because there's a lot more to dig into, for sure.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Well, it was a pleasure. It was a pleasure to listen to everybody tonight, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, my pleasure, too, to hear our students. Man, you guys are fantastic.
Oh, man, so much talent. Ridiculous.
Yeah,
it's exciting.
So
to wrap up here in a minute.
Yeah.
And yeah. So, I just want to say one more time, thank you. I mean, this is awesome. And I know for Austin, we don't get this every day. We, you know, for Texas Jazz and Blues Camp, that's annual. Joe Morales and I have been talking, and Andre, about trying to do these more frequently. But if we can get the word out that these awesome people are from Austin, Texas. I mean, you're not from New York. You're not, you know, this is happening here. So we just want to get everyone to be thinking that way, spread the word. And Joe's Austin Jazz Club is growing and going to include New School Jazz Clubs. So just let people know. And thanks again to Don and Bill, Joe and Andre. And all these awesome players, it's just incredible. Anything else, Joe?
Well, I want to add thanks to Monks, by the way, as well.
Yeah. Oh, I
know you're about to say that. So.
Yeah, Colin is a genius back there. It's amazing to see what he does.
Yeah, man.
That guy is a wizard, man. I'm going to call him the wizard.
Yeah, he helped a lot. He helped me a lot.
That's his new nickname.
Here we go.
So, Bill, you remember when we Boots Randolph tore us apart over that at Willie's party? Like, I don't know, that was like 20 years ago. You remember that?
No.
That's classic Cat,
it was,
man.
Boots Randolph. I don't know. He shredded us. But anyway, quick story. So I take Bill to the Elephant Room one night here in Austin, and the guy running the jam session said, who's that? I said, that's Bill Evans. And he goes, yeah, right. So Bill gets up to play, and he, I don't know, does some burning tune. And so I walk back out in the audience, and the guy running the jam session goes, shit, that's Bill Evans.
I do remember now.
You do remember me. Yes, sir.
I do remember. You know, I got to tell you, I recorded with Boots Randolph years ago. I wanted to do some different types of music, and I went to Nashville and about 22 years ago. It's not out. It never came out. It was just an idea I had, and I had Boots Randolph play together, and we were going to trade on his tune, on Yakety Sax, his tune, and he was afraid I was going to do this, you know, improvisational New York burnout, whatever kind of style. And he did the most interesting slap-tonguing thing on the saxophone that I've never heard. And I stopped and I said, how do you do that?
Wow.
So it was, he was going, and I just went, whoa, wait a minute. Wow. And it would have sounded really stupid if I would come in, and all of a sudden he comes in. And so I tried to do my little version of that or whatever, and it was really fun, you know, to kind of like, yeah, he was a master entertainer, and he was a really good guy, I must say.
Very cool. All
and he thought I was going to be this guy from New York coming in with his big New York attitude, and he said, right, man, you're just a regular guy, Bill.
That's cool.
I'll take that as a compliment.
Absolutely.
Well, Joe, it was good seeing you too, man.
Good seeing you too, Bill.
Well, see all you guys again.
Yeah, thank you so much. 2022, we got, I'm bringing Don down, and then 2023, you're in, Bill.
Okay.
All right, babe. Thank you so much, guys. Let jazz live on with the youth, and we'd like to say good night. Thank you, Don. Thank you, Bill.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Bill.
All right. Thank you, Don. Hey, Don, thanks again for the help, man.
Yeah, brother. Anytime, man.
I'm hearing you play, too, man.
Back at you. Back at you. Sounds fantastic. Looking forward to playing together soon.
All right. That's it, huh?
I guess. They didn't say 3-2-1 out. They should say
3-2-1 yeah, right.
One, brah. That's what they're supposed to say. The kids are getting up and scattering, so I guess that's a sign that we're...
Okay, I guess. All right. I guess I'll sign off.
Yeah, brother. Thanks again.
Take care. Thank you, John.
Stay in touch, man.
Absolutely. Thanks. I'm glad we got this connection.
Me too, man. Well done. Doing, man. Thanks for everything. Thanks for all your wisdom.
You, man.
All
right.
Have a good night, brother.
Thank you.
Cannonball.
Thanks, Colin. Appreciate it, man. Thank you. Have a good night.